So let me introduce the last of experimental phenomena that people were trying to explain that leading to all these quantum assumptions. And actually, I guess in terms of quantum assumptions, I have introduced everything that needs to be introduced. So as a reminder, this is where they all came from. This idea that the energy of light waves or electromagnetic radiation comes in discrete packets. This is coming from the black body radiation. And photoelectric effect. People have been trying to explain this phenomena on the basis of some basic laws of physics, and the only way to explain this was by introducing this assumption. Right? Now, when I introduced this assumption, I kind of put it forward like this was some fun idea that de Broglie was having, and he had no reason to suggest this. I don't think that's historically correct for one. And there's another thing in the background that was really leading de Broglie to suggest that this relationship might be more general than just the light. The whole wave-particle duality might not be just a funny property of light. Instead, it might be a more universal phenomenon. And this, if I'm trying to actually motivate this, this is how we would motivate it. You could call this, if you, you know, just want a phrase that you can Google search, you might call this stability of hydrogen atom. And really, it doesn't have to be specifically hydrogen atom. It could be really any atom, stability of atom. When you say that kind of sounds a little bit funny. What do you guys know about atoms already? I don't think we have talked about atoms yet in this class. Like, what are atoms? No one here knows what an atom is? I mean, you've heard of them, right? They talk about this starting in like a middle school. They don't really explain what they are, but if you want to trace back the idea of atom, like where would you say it comes from? Like from your general science education. Chemistry is actually a good place. So the good starting place that starts with the modern physics, you can go all the way back to the Greeks, but I would rather not, is the periodic table, because that's where you have the modern description of, I don't know what I want, maybe this one, okay, yeah. That's where we have the modern description of an element, the idea that all this different matter is composed of things that don't easily change. Like when I won't do it, but if I hit it somewhere and bend it, the object itself changes, but it's made up of other things that themselves do not change. And chemists have done a bunch of experiments to figure out that there are these different elements, and they come in. Why do I have that annoying? Oh. Wait, sorry. How do I zoom out? All right, that's good. And they've discovered that, for example, pencil lead, which is made out of carbon, has different property than, aluminum, which makes up metallic things or whatever. And they've tested the properties. Somebody discovered that the properties of these are periodic. In particular, they were looking at reactivity. So hydrogen, well, it reacts with almost anything. So let's skip. Like lithium, sodium, potassium, and these are kind of later, rubidium, cesium, francium. These are all highly reactive material. And when people look at the compounds that lithium, sodium, and potassium form, they tend to form with like fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. So tend to form with these other elements. And for example, like when sodium forms a compound with chlorine to form sodium chloride, what is that? Yeah, it sounds dangerous, it's not. Well, it can be. So so that's what the chemists did. So these elements were known since, I keep telling you, physicists are not good historians. I want to say like 1700s, 1800s, that's when they figured out most of this chemistry stuff. So this idea of element is scientifically established. You know that they exist. What people didn't know is, so what are these elements like? I mean, are they, so you know, back in the days of Greece, they had the idea of the 4+1 elements. You know, fire, water, earth, air. Wait, did I forget something? Yeah, fire, water, earth, air, and then ether. That's the classical idea of elements. And when you had those only, you know, 4 or 5 things, it was really easy to kind of imagine what they would be. You say, you know, if something is metallic, then you say it's, you know, it's like made up of earth element in some mixture with the fire element or whatever. When you have, I think, I'm pretty sure they've discovered something close to 100 elements before the days of, well, at least 80 elements or so. Gold, they know, so at least 80 elements or so. When you have this many elements, it becomes harder for you to say that, because this stainless steel, it's made up of really only 2 elements. Well, 2 big ones, carbon and iron. So you need to have a more better idea of, okay, this basic material that's making up our world, we don't have only 5 of them. We are going to have dozens and dozens of them. So we really need to be able to describe these in terms of more fundamental quantities. More, so you need to be able to say, for example, you need to be able to relate how carbon is different from oxygen. In a way, you can say that, well, carbon is made up of, I guess, 6 of something, and oxygen is made up of 8 of something else, something, the same thing. But the way they are different is that carbon has 6 of them, oxygen has 8 of them.